scientists, politicians, sports champs, celebrity chefs, a quilt maker and barramundi farmers, 992 inspirational Aussies were honoured in the Queen's birthday list. The late, great Shane Warne among the batch of sporting luminaries.
And he's done it.
He really was a selfless and remarkable man.
As well as triple Grand Slam champ and tennis legend, Ash Barty.
Ash Barty is the Australian Open champion.
Women making up 46% of recipients, the second highest percentage in the awards history.
If you want to change the world, study science.
If she can do it, I can do it too.
Among our everyday humble heroes receiving gongs.
You know, I just go about doing my job.
I'm a small cog in part of a bigger wheel.
I'm inspired by the people around me.
And teacher's aide, Jill Smith, who makes quilts for charities.
I couldn't believe it. I saw the email and I thought it was spam.
And Julie Tyson and Bob Richards, who run the largest barramundi farm in Australia.
Pretty much everyone have contributed one way or another.
But like everything else in our lives right now, the honours were largely shaped by the pandemic. Among the 92 Australians recognised for their efforts combating COVID, New South Wales Chief Health Officer Dr Kerry Chant and everyone's favourite, Professor Mary Louise McClaws, awarded for her service to medical research.
I was really, really shocked. It's a wonderful gift.
Former Queensland Chief Health Officer Dr Jeanette Young.
This has been the textbook response. It truly has been superb.
And our former Chief Medical Officer Dr Brendan Murphy, one of nine new Companions of the Order of Australia.
It is likely to spread, but we don't need to panic.
The highest distinction awarded in this year's Queen's Birthday Honours. Onyas.
And Dr Brendan Murphy joins us now. Congrats. Now, did you ever imagine in the field that you're in that you'd be making decisions that would impact lives in the way that they did during this pandemic?
No, obviously I didn't. I should point out that I didn't make the decisions. I provided the advice to governments who made those decisions.
they blamed you for the decisions a lot of the time.
Yeah, but I provided advice along with AGPPC during the early stages of the pandemic, and certainly when I became Chief Medical Officer, I didn't think for a minute that we'd have a pandemic. It was a very, very, quite frightening and strange time in that early phase of the pandemic.
Brendan, a lot of us, we jigsawed our way through lockdown, we sourdoughed our way, we learned a second language and gave up after a few days. What did you do to get yourself through the pandemic?
For the first 6 months, I just worked and I tried. I used to go to the gym, but that was hard because we had the gym shut. So walking was quite important, trying to get a bit of sleep. But I really didn't have any time off at all in that first 6 months. I just worked every 7 days a week most days. And we just felt the need to do that because, you know, the implications of the decisions or the recommendations we were making were so momentous that we had to get it right.
Brendan, I've got to ask you straight. Was homeschooling your idea?
Well, I'd have to... Look, I don't want to go back into all of that policy, but I have to say that AGPPC and me particularly were never particularly strong on closing schools. We had a fairly strong view early on that schools should stay open as much as possible because early on, and even now, COVID is not a particularly significant disease in kids. That was never a formal AGPPC recommendation, at least when I was chair of it.
Did you realise how much parents like Chrissy Swan would love it?
I think the mental health impact of those lockdowns, particularly, you know, in Victoria, which had such long lockdowns, were pretty significant, and that's why we'll still be living with those impacts for some time.
Speaking of living, we've been looking at the idea that we're living with COVID these days, Dr Murphy, but we're still seeing around 300 Australians a week dying.
Yeah.
How much does that number concern you, and does it need to come down?
Well, it does concern me. I mean, we don't know how many of those deaths are directly caused by COVID infection that could have been prevented. Some of them are due to in people who have other terminal conditions and get COVID at the end of life, but it still concerns us. So the way we're managing COVID now is to protect the vulnerable. Make sure that everybody gets a third vaccination dose. Everyone had their first two, but some people still haven't had the third dose and the fourth dose if you're eligible. And obviously, if you're vulnerable, you know, and you're susceptible to COVID, they're the sort of people who probably should still be wearing masks in crowded spaces.
That's all really good advice.
Mm. Yeah. Dr. Brendan Murphy, thanks very much and congratulations.
Okay, guys. Thank you.